Happy New Year, everybody. 2022 was an interesting yet challenging year for many people, myself included. COVID has really shaken up our world and changed so many things from our daily lives to how we interact with one another. After almost 3 years, instead of looking forward to COVID going away completely, we've learned to live with it, to manage our lives around it, and to expect the unexpected. 2022 was a year of contemplation for me. After losing a few friends during COVID and two to suicide, I was forced to look within and analyze my own life and really think about my place in the world and the meaning of my own existence. Why are we here and why do we do what we do? With that running in the background of my thoughts, I started having deeper and more meaningful conversations with the people I meet, and that's when my new photo project was conceived, and it's called Chasing the American Dream. I started going around interviewing and photographing people who to me are chasing their dreams and following their life's purpose. Though they all came from different backgrounds, race, gender, upbringing, etc., they all have that same spark in their eyes that I so coveted. They're as unique and different as they can be, but when it comes to their work, they exude passion, confidence, and above all, contentment. Thanks to the Darkroom Lab, I had the pleasure of meeting Mat Marrash, a Columbus, Ohio-based photographer in Joshua Tree last year. Mat specializes in medium and large format photography, as well as alternative photographic processes. After a casual conversation about photography, social media, and life in general, I knew I had to interview and photograph him, hoping to capture that spark in his eyes and understand what makes Mat, Mat.
I'm originally from Northwest Ohio. I was actually born on the East Coast, but that's a whole thing. I went to school in Northwest Ohio, went to the University of Findlay, which is also right along 23. I'm just kind of making my way south as I go. At this rate, I'm probably gonna die in Cincinnati. You know, just keep going south. But I went to school for biology. So I have my degrees in biology with a minor in chemistry. That was like my big thing. Science, techie stuff I'm always into, but I kind of struggled my last year, not because of like grades or anything, but I just didn't feel like as stuff was gaining, like responsibility wise, it didn't feel like this was what I wanted. I loved being in the lab. I loved experimenting. I loved doing field work stuff. We did like river water studies, all of that. I loved it. But I didn't like what I was kind of seeing on like the administration side of things. So like I would always talk to my professors in their after hours, like, so I get that you're doing research, but like, what else do you have to do to, and they always talk to me about all the different, you know, smoke and mirror stuff they would have to do in order to secure funding or who their funding was coming from. And it was kind of weird. My school that I went to was basically like, we were literally the Findlay Oilers. It's all tied in very much with oil and natural gas. And as I was getting further and further into that, my field of study that I loved doing was bioremediation, which is using natural flora and fauna to clean up things like oil and natural gas spills, which was a direct conflict of interest of the very money that went to all of the schools that I was looking to get into. And that is incredibly disenfranchising as somebody that like wants to, that felt like they wanted to help that situation and discover things, and finding that even my peers and people I looked up to, their research and hard work was actually just being buried by corporate interest. And that like hit me really, really hard. This was also around the same time that I had a bunch of other like life stuff going on, and I needed a break. And during this big break and reset, I took this opportunity that the school had to take this massive summer-long trip to Japan. And I really wanted to remember the trip, and I heard the best way to do that would be to use this this DSLR camera. I had no idea what the heck that was. So I went online and I bought the cheapest one I could afford, and I like overnighted it, and I taught myself the basics of how to use it poorly. And then I went on the trip and took like 50,000 RAW files over the course of the summer, because RAW was like, I read a blog post that said, you're nothing if you don't shoot RAW. So I did that, and then I came back with all these terrible pictures, bad exposure, bad color, and whatever. But I was hooked. I was like hopelessly addicted. And by the time I came back, this would have been like my super senior year, my fifth year, I took a job as the student photographer for the school. And what was really like another punch to the gut was showing up regularly with a camera to like school events, like basketball games and dinners and stuff, actually got me more access and more notoriety at the school than like 4 years of busting my butt with a high GPA. And it kind of taught me I can get places, not necessarily with like my grades and playing by that playbook, and I can do it with a camera. So I wanted to keep doing that. And I wanted to see where it would take me. And pretty quickly into working with the camera a lot more, I noticed I wasn't just meeting new people and getting access to these cool places. I was seeing all these different approaches with photography. I knew my professor was a commercial and fine art photographer, and other photographers did like events and sports, and you could kind of like suit that to your niche. So I started trying to integrate photography into other things I did, but I also felt like the pictures I was taking didn't feel like my own. This was like early digital, so like 2008 kind of digital, where the cameras were still pretty terrible, and like smartphones were like a very brand new thing, so the cameras on those weren't good yet either. And upon taking a second trip back to Japan, I'm also like a huge anime and video game fan, that's a whole thing, but I came back from that trip more jazzed about photography, and I went to these like really high-end camera stores there with stuff I couldn't afford in like Shinjuku and stuff. And when I was there, they had like this reverence, this beautiful glass case with all these wonderful like Leica and other cameras. There was one camera there that I was like obsessed with, and I just wanted to learn more about it. And it's this guy right here. So I came back and I found somebody who was basically giving away their Hasselblads. This is my first film, like my first dive into film, my Hasselblad 500C. And it's pretty much all downhill from here. I shot this for a few months. I forced myself to take pictures with it every week, at least a roll of film a week. And before I knew it, I had a big large format camera in my hands. So I jumped right from this is medium format film to 8x10 film. And then after that, I ended up on the podcast that I was a fanboy for, the Film Photography Podcast. And pretty soon I was integrating all of this photography stuff into my life. And then I started working at a camera store here in Columbus, Ohio, and then I moved down here. And then I found this, my good buddy, Mr. Steven Takis. He's another great photographer here in Columbus. And we started sharing this darkroom space back here together. And it's kind of crazy. Time feels like it's completely blown by, and now I'm surrounding my whole life in photography. You know, my dream is really just a simplistic one, to live like decently comfortably while not feeling like too pushed down by other external factors I can't control. So maybe not working like a job that makes me feel completely lifeless. I do like genuinely like working, so that's why I don't mind overburdening myself with the really heavy stuff at times. I do believe in like the value of hard work, but I'm not like disillusioned that everybody has to work and grind super, super hard. That's not what some people's dream is. But mine personally, it's put in a lot of work, put in like genuine effort, and again, not try to step on anybody else in the process, which as an American is kind of hard because just our very existence burdens other people around the world all the time. So being conscious of that can kind of stink, but I'm trying to find a happy medium, simplify things, not consume too much all the time. And when I do take something, I want to give it back as much as possible. And I think I've also learned that from, you know, being a big fan of like natural landscapes and the very limited environment that we have. So just live comfortably, have something nice for my loved ones, and put in a little bit of work so it makes it feel all worthwhile. So I think to make my own, you know, dream or whatever kind of happen, there are some things. So to live the life I currently live, there have been some things that I've given up, but turns out I don't really miss them as much as I thought I did. I was really scared at first. So, you know, currently now I'm mostly like a freelancer. I do some contract education work, and I also do the YouTube channel and content stuff and a little bit of the artsy fartsy stuff as well. In doing so, it doesn't offer the same stability as like the normal 9 to 5 clocking in every day, but I don't think a lot of us understand, if we've only known school to that, how much of your life is just getting prepared for those things. And having some of that back, that extra little bit of freedom, is totally worth some of that other little bit of instability. I know that's not for everyone, because some folks have, there are lesser abled folks. There's folks that have more responsibility in terms of like siblings or children or anything. So I'm conscious of that, and I'm really, really thankful that there are folks that do put in that extra effort to, you know, make it easier for them. But a lot of what I've given up are just kind of a lot of the material things that many people would just consider necessities. So like, we don't have a lot of streaming stuff. We don't, like, all just like the creature comforts. I don't have too many of those, but I don't need to be comfortable. I need to be working, so. Ooh, that is a really good question. I really hope everybody has a purpose. I really like to think that that a purpose is something that's achievable for folks. But I also, being someone who's like really into video games, I also like to think of how people excel at certain things, and their skills are kind of like those, you know, RPG or role-playing games where everybody is born with a set of stats, and I'm really good at this. So some people have a proclivity to, like, some people are born with an innate talent to just listen to a piece of music and they're able to like recreate it on a piano. There's some people that have that talent, or that ear or that eye for something, or they notice really early on they're good with their hands. So I think we all have those skills, but what we are increasingly lacking is the ability to find that out, because there's all these external factors that provide undue pressure on all of us. Some of us have some extra advantages and extra money and extra people that can help us with it, and others don't. And yeah, I think purpose is something that usually needs a little bit of discovery or work toward. I don't think anybody wakes up and they just know their purpose and they have all the right tools. Unfortunately, there is just too much and too many to rely on just waking up and having that. But I think it's something that we're able to achieve, and that requires discovery and practicing around with those things, and definitely failing a lot along the way too. Nothing that we see from other folks that are succeeding or happy, or any of the things that people push out there in the media landscape, none of that is overnight. So the overnight success, or someone instantly became that, always what's not celebrated is people that are working towards something, putting in effort. If we celebrated that, we would be putting farmers on pedestals and not celebrities for things. And even celebrities work a lot too. So we don't see a lot of the work that goes behind the scenes. Sometimes it's months, years. In some fields, it's decades before somebody is a breakout overnight success. So everybody wants, you know, what we're fed too tells us that we need to do something now, and we need to be the best at it now. And to do that, you need to consume, 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 and buy all these wonderful things. And really, we just need to start. Half of what I do when I'm like teaching a lesson in photography is telling somebody to slow down. And I think that's my favorite thing about giant tools like these, is it literally forces you to slow down. And I know that's kind of a trope in film photography at this point, but slowing down is a big part of it. And if you want to work toward a goal, start in the simplest way possible and take your time. I guess you can cut it down to that. But yeah, start with the simplest thing possible, pair it into small achievable goals, and work your way toward it. And when you do that, you're gonna be less disappointed in not achieving these big goals, and you may discover that you didn't even want that goal in the first place. What you want is something completely different. What I have now and I'm happy with now is not what I would have thought I wanted 1, 2, 5 years ago. So just work slowly at it and work at these little achievable things. And if it changes, great, you've got time.
In a way, working on this project is like pursuing my dream. My dream of not just being the photographer and observer that I am, but someone that understands humanity with compassion and inspires others to follow their dreams. With so much focus and emphasis on cameras and gear in the photography world, especially on social media, I decided to keep things simple and shoot the project with my favorite 1956 Rolleiflex camera in Kodak portrait film. Here's some shots from my day with Matt. Even as a fellow photographer, observing Matt shoot and process his film was quite a fascinating experience. He reminded me of a mad scientist or chemist with so much knowledge and passion, not just in photography, but in all types of chemicals and how they react with one another. It nevertheless made me wonder what people think when they see me shoot or talk about photography. Do I exude the same kind of passion and confidence? In this new year, I invite all of you to join me and follow your passion. Do things that make you happy, that allow you to be in your element. But never do so at someone else's expense. Lift people up with you. Be kind, understanding, and compassionate to others. Live, don't just exist. Improve, don't just make mistakes. Thrive, don't just survive.